You and I are worlds apart. Here I am, talking about facts, real people, events. And you're talking about a 2,000-year-old book with stories in it that... Let's talk reality.
You want to talk reality?
Yeah.
Well, reality was 3.5 years ago when your husband and millions of others vanished. Now, that's reality.
They said it was UFOs.
Would you like to hear the Bible's version?
Mm-hmm. It's 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with a trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. That's reality. You want facts? Over 300 prophecies in the Bible have come to pass since the birth of Christ.
Sounds like you've studied it.
I've searched this book through and through.
What's going to happen?
God's wrath will pour out on the earth through the trumpet judgments. They can begin any time now. God's message to man is repent. Turn from Satan's deception to Jesus for salvation. So even though the body may be destroyed, the soul will escape judgment.
Well, we're all just like cattle waiting for the slaughter. Well, what happens? Will it be worse than what we've been going through?
Yes, it'll be worse. The first trumpet is a judgment of fire on the earth's vegetation. Forest and grass fires ignited by lightning mingled with hail and blood. It's a plague on men for their thanklessness for what God provided on a productive earth.
Isn't that a literal interpretation, though?
The plagues of Egypt were literal, verified by secular history. We have to be careful not to wish away the trumpet plagues by thinking there'll be social, political, or economic problems. According to Revelation chapter 8, verse 8, and the second angel sounded, and as it were, a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea, making the third part of the sea into blood. One third of the marine life will die. Shipping will be destroyed. And people who turn to the sea for food when the drought came will starve. Trumpet number 3 is a plague on drinking water. According to Revelation 8, verses 10 and 11, a burning meteor called wormwood falls to earth, polluting the rivers and poisoning one third of the drinking water. Trumpet number 4 is a plague of darkness on the earth. One third of the sun, moon, and stars will go dark. In like manner, spiritual darkness will settle over the world. Trumpet number 5 unleashes a plague of smoke and locusts from the pit. It is the center of the earth. What a frightful creature this locust will be. A body of a horse, human face, crown on the head, long hair, and lion's teeth, and wings that sound like thundering horses rushing into battle. And worse, they have long tails and stings like scorpions. The sting is terrible. It doesn't kill you, it just leaves you in a state of torment for 5 months. Only those sealed by God will be exempt. It's an intense, horrible torment. Death will be preferable, but not possible. Trumpet number 6 consists of 200 million horses and horsemen loosed to destroy one third of the earth's population.
200 million horses?
There were that many horses in China in the late 70s. Anyway, the 7th trumpet is a review of all the others, a warning to men. This is not God's temper tantrum. It's a sifting process to get the lost to respond to Christ.
But today's temple is defiled by the worst sacrilege that could possibly befall Israel.
Really? What happened?
The computer. The computer has been the most innovative and time-saving device known to man. Paid bills, made travel reservations, cooked meals. It's the new golden calf. A computer that speaks and convinces people that it thinks. Hundreds of millions of people will worship that inanimate object, and it's in the temple.
My friends and loyal subjects, for the last 4 years, we have worked together to overcome the greatest physical hardships the world has ever known. World war, drought, famine, pestilence, fire, earthquakes, and volcanoes of unprecedented violence. But we have prevailed, thanks to our fantastic computer technology and the intervention of His Satanic Majesty. Where, dear friend, was the loving God of creation during our recent perils? Was He helping mankind, the children of His creation? No. On the contrary, it is He who has visited these disasters upon us. And to you, God, God of wrath and destruction to mankind, I say, do your worst, but we will prevail.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have just heard Brother Christopher live via UTN, the United Television Network, bringing you the evening message.
Cain and Abel portray the eternal truths that there are only two choices and that there are only two destinations in life. There are not three, there are not many, there's not a stopover for people that didn't quite make it and they can kind of get purified and purged and finally make it. There are only two choices in life that you have to make while you're alive and breathing and conscious, and there are only two destinations depending on which choice you make. That's the message of God's word. And two lines run through the history of mankind, the line of Christ and the line of the Antichrist, the line of the woman's seed, Genesis 3:15, and the line of the serpent's seed. And the way we know that is, by the time we get to John chapter 8, verse 44, Jesus looked at a group of highly religious people. I mean, these people wore white clothes most of the time. These people would go through their garden and they'd click off every tenth leaf in their garden. They would give one tenth of everything to the Lord. And they were constantly, you know, quoting scripture and offering sacrifices. And Jesus looked at them, the single most righteous and religious visible people of his day. And he said, your father is the devil. Now, they didn't appreciate that. And they got very angry and they tried to stone him. But what he was saying is, there's only two families. And if you're involved in a religion of keeping man-made rules and of trying to accomplish enough goodness to please whatever you call God, you're in religion and your father is the devil. By the way, we were all born as the devil's children. We have to be born a second time to become a son and daughter of God. If you're just counting on your first birth, you're a son or daughter of Satan. You have to have a second new birth to have eternal life, to get into God's family. Well, there are only two groups of people always on earth, and they're headed to very different destinations. Number one, there is the way of the God followers. They are like Abel. He is an example. They kneel before a substitutionary bloody sacrifice that point, for Abel, it pointed forward to Golgotha. For us today, it points backward to Golgotha's wonderful offering once and for all of Christ. But they kneel at a substitutionary blood sacrifice pointing to Golgotha and are justified only by faith, not by works. They're justified by faith and they go to heaven. That's the way of the God follower. There's also the way of the Satan follower, and they're just like Cain. They kneel at the altar of their good work, their self-styled coming to God, and they point to Babel, because we're going to see in a moment when we get to chapter 10 and 11 that all idolatry and all self-styled pagan religion we see around the world, and even what we see in the heart of Roman Catholicism, goes right back to Genesis 10 and 11. Solomon put it well, there's nothing new under the sun. That Pontifex Maximus that was imported from Pergamus to Rome in the first century BC, by the fourth century BC, it's conferred upon the Holy Catholic Church, and it became the holy, or I should say, the unholy Roman Catholic Church in the fourth century. That is the way of Cain. And condemned by their own sins, by the way, Ezekiel 33 says, our sins are like an avalanche, and it's like every sin we've ever committed is just cascading down the hill toward us. And unless someone stands in the way of our sin and takes it upon himself, that sin follows us into the grave, and it's what sinks us in the lake of fire forever. Did you know one sin is enough to sink forever? And most of us have committed exponentially more than one sin. And only one person can take my avalanche of sin and not just say, oh, it doesn't matter, but he absorbs it on himself. And that's what Cain refused, and he went to the lake of fire. So there are two families everyone's a part of, either God's or Satan's. There are only two destinations ahead of every human that's ever lived on this earth, heaven or hell. And life is reduced to one of the two choices, repent or reject. Each of us today belongs to one family or the other. It's what you've chosen. Have you chosen to come God's way through a bloody, substitutionary, atoning sacrifice of a perfect God, man? Or are you coming any other way? By keeping these rules and trying real hard and hoping, praying this or that, or trusting in the sacrifice? Well, here in Genesis 4, I want to show you that Cain and Abel are not only two actual people who lived and walked on earth a few thousand years ago. They represent the two roads, the two groups, the two families, the two directions. And basically, if we look at their choices, and I just want to go with you through the simple observation of the choices that Cain and Abel make. If you look at their choices, you can see which family they're in. Because remember, they're so similar. Both Cain and Abel were born outside of Eden. Both were sinners and fallen. Both were lost and guilty of in each of their own personal sins. But only Abel was willing to admit that. Cain wouldn't admit it. And so they have remarkably different trajectories. First of all, Genesis contrasts in chapter 4 Satan's followers by Cain and God's followers by the life of Abel. And to help us understand the magnitude of the doctrinal lesson, I want to look at their lives separately. Satan's religion is the wicked way of Cain. That's what it's called in both Jude and 1 John. It's called the way of Cain. What is the way of Cain? Number one, Cain neglected God's example of a bloody substitute for covering sinners. Remember, God said, I'll be well pleased if you do what I do. Offer a blood sacrifice, a substitute. Cain neglected that, and he got angry when God corrected him. You know, that's the first sign of one of these self-styled practitioners. They get angry if you tell them. That's, you know, interesting. But that's not true. This is true. How do you know that's not true? I've studied everything, and I've surveyed all the world religions. Uh-huh. And there are a lot of them, and Satan is going to keep showing you more of them. Either you believe the revelation, or you take the lie of religion. There's no middle ground. And Cain believed the lie and got angry when God corrected him. Secondly, Cain portrays a salvation that's based on human merit. It embodies the natural self-righteous self-sufficiency of a lost person. They are formal. They follow some set of rules that they have adhered to. They have external only profession. It has not transformed them on the inside. And the Bible says that they are trusting in their works. One form or another, they're trusting in their works. Thirdly, Cain was rejected and cursed by God. God summarily rejected that religion, he said. And Cain, because he didn't respond, was cursed by God. Cain denied he was lost. He refused the divine remedy, and he became merely religious, but he still was lost. See, you can be very religious, but lost. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 7, in the church, he said, there are going to be many religious people. I mean, they're just around it. They know how to pray. They've learned a lot of Bible stories. They can do all the stuff. They can teach. They go on missions trips, but they're not trusting personally, invisibly, in the substitute, Jesus Christ. And Jesus will say, yeah, you did all that stuff. You're in church and everything else, but I didn't know you personally. You never came my way through one door my way. Next, Cain looked for help from inside of himself to please God. He thought, oh, what can I do? This is what I'll do. And it was a self-internal prompting rather than doing what God revealed. He offered an unbloody offering. He ignores the curse-removing substitutionary blood sacrifice his brother Abel offered. Next, Cain was the father of all those who seek their security in the earth. Remember, he brought from the fruit of the ground. And by the time we get, that's in Genesis, by the time we get to Revelation, you know how God describes people going to hell in Revelation? He calls them earth dwellers. Their whole life is encompassed by the earth, and everything here is what they live for. Finally, Cain turned from the true altar of worship to God. He ignored the message, God's warning. And you know what he does by verse 17? He founds a whole bunch of cities. I mean, he shows that this is what he's living for, the earth, not for the pursuit of God and heaven. Well, that's Satan's religion. That's the wicked way of Cain. What is God's revelation? What if we distilled down what God revealed in his word and that Abel did, what would that be? It's the righteous faith of Abel. Number one, Abel followed God's example. He offered a bloody substitute as an offering for his sin. He offered the very best of his flock. You know what he did? He humbly gave God what God asked him to give. I mean, that's all we're supposed to do. God doesn't ask us to think up something new and spend our whole life, you know, trying to think up something. He said, just give me humbly what I asked for. Secondly, Abel portrays a salvation that's only by grace. It's divine grace. A spiritual person becomes broken-spirited. They take God's side against themselves, and they are saved because they're a genuine believer and possessor in Christ's finished work. They believe Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Abel accepted and was blessed by God. He acknowledged his personal sins. He believed God's testimony. He put his faith in the substitute, and it says in Hebrews he was accounted righteous. He was a genuinely saved person. He's the first example of someone we know of. In fact, if you think about it, he was the first person in paradise, in the place God promised for those that loved him. He was first to be able to enjoy the worship of God forever. Abel came to the true altar of worship. He heeded God's message, and he found it led to a grave stained with blood. Did you know following the Lord isn't always easy? He got martyred for his faith and because he was a witness. Well, the way of Cain and the way of Abel go on until the time of the flood. Turn over to chapter 7 with me in Genesis real quick. Notice there's no mention of idolatry. If you read this, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, and 9, there is no mention of idolatry before the flood is over, before God floods the earth. He only floods them because their works were so evil. They were completely united in their rebellion against God, and the demons had intruded, and that whole Genesis 6 thing was going on of a genetic change of humans to no longer be completely human. I thought it was interesting this week that Britain finally uncovered the fact they have secret labs where they're cloning animals and human embryos, and they're trying to make creatures that are partially human and partially animals. It's very similar to demon-human things that were going on before the flood, and God stopped that, and that's just another reason why we're very close. As soon as man has the ability to genetically alter and make something that's not fully human, God stops it because Jesus only died for humans. He didn't die for asteroid dwellers and, you know, people in another galaxy far away. He died for humans, and that's amazing. But we won't go into science fiction. Look at chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. God destroyed the whole earth in the flood. If you pause in Genesis 7, 21, you notice that God's word says every human and every air-breathing animal. Let me read it. You just follow along. You might want to circle this. And all flesh died that moved on the earth, verse 21. 21 says, birds and cattle and beasts and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth and every man. Now, did you get it? Verse 21. Well, God says, you might not have been listening. Look at verse 22. All in whose nostrils was the breath of the Spirit of life. All that was on dry land died. Verse 23. Did you get it? Maybe not. Verse 23. So he destroyed all living things which were on the face of the ground. Both man and cattle, creeping things and birds of the air, they were destroyed from the earth. Only Noah and those who were with him in the ark remained alive. Now, with a simple second grade education or even a first grade education, what would you conclude from studying that? Would you conclude that it was a localized flood in the Black Sea region that National Geographic just announced? They said, oh, they finally found Noah's flood. It's in the Black Sea region. They found a part of the Black Sea that is, I don't know, 1,500 feet deep, and there's a village at the bottom of the Black Sea that's all still there. The houses, all of the tools and implements, and it's in super cold water. It's in 32 degree water that hasn't frozen. And everything is preserved perfectly, and they're sending their little submarines down. They said, ah, they're going to look for Noah and find him down there, they think, you know? Well, God says all of the earth, every animal, every human, not just in Mesopotamia, not just along the Nile Valley, not just in the Black Sea region, God destroyed the whole earth in the flood. If there was a global flood that covered the whole earth, you would find fossils at the top of the Andes, at the top of the Himalayas, at the top of the Rockies, at the top of everything. And guess what? You do. There are fossils on the mountaintops of every mountain range in the world because God flooded all the earth. Look at chapter 8, verse 18. The next point is this. Worship God first. Worship his way. So Noah went and his sons, look at verse 18, and went out of the ark, and every animal, verse 19, every creeping thing and every bird and whatever creeps on the earth according to their families, they went out of the ark. And verse 20, what is the first thing as soon as they landed, as soon as the ground dried, as soon as the ark was emptied, what was the very first thing that God desired? Verse 20, as soon as everybody had disembarked, Noah built an altar to the Lord. Approach God in worship first. And when you worship him, worship his way. Do it God's way. And he offered of every clean animal and of every clean bird, he offered burnt offering on the altar. And the Lord smelled the soothing aroma and on and on. By the way, just a side note, did you know the ark of Noah is one of the most profound pictures of Christ and salvation? Have you ever thought about that? I mean, just the minor details. God invited them in. Did you ever think about that? It says, and God said, come in. If you read the account, God was in the ark. He said, come on in. Anybody that's saved, God initiates salvation. God invites us to come to him. Secondly, there was only one door. God had one door to the ark, and the door didn't have a handle. I bet that puzzled Noah. There was no handle. It says that God shut the door himself. Noah didn't pull on something. God shut the door. There was only one door in, and it's amazing. The word, he covered the ark with pitch. You know, they made it of gopher wood, and they pitched it. You know what the word pitch is in Hebrew? Kafar. You know what kafar is translated everywhere else in the Bible? Atonement. Atonement means to cover and to separate so that nothing can get to it. It's covered over with a covering. Just like the blood of the sacrifices covers over our sins so they're not seen anymore. The ark was atoned with pitch. In other words, anybody that was inside the ark was covered, atoned for. So that's fascinating. But look at verse 16 of chapter 7. I want to show you something because the ark portrays eternal security. You know, one of the earliest doctrines in the Bible is grace. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord, Genesis 6. You know what the second earliest doctrine of the Bible is? Eternal security. What is that? Genesis 7, verse 16. It says, so those that entered, male and female of all flesh, went in as God commanded, and the Lord shut him in. Okay, now turn over to chapter 8, verse 19. Every animal, every creeping thing, every bird, whatever creeps on the earth, according to their families, went out of the ark. Did you know everything that went in the one door and that God shut and sealed? You know, it says that we're sealed by the Holy Spirit, that we come to Christ, and the Bible says we are in Christ, we are sealed by the Holy Spirit, held by our Father's hand. It's a three-part security system. And everybody who got in the ark, man, woman, animal, creeping thing, survived the whole flood, and God opened the door, and look at verse 19 of chapter 8. Every animal, I would have said most of the creeping things, most of the birds, God says they all did. It's amazing. The ark is a picture of all who come to Christ through his way of salvation, the one door, are kept safely to the end and arrive safely home. So for all of you that are slugging through Hebrews 6, you know what it doesn't mean, okay? It doesn't mean that someone got in the ark of salvation and one of the boards got loose and they fell out and they drowned. That's how some people interpret Hebrews 6. You always interpret one hard-to-find verse in the Bible with the totality of everything else the Bible says. And the Bible says if you come to Christ, he shuts the door, can't get out. You're safe forever. Well, real quickly, look at chapter 10. Genesis 10, starting in verse 8, introduces us to the mighty Nimrod, the founder of Babel. Now, most people don't like history, but this is some of the most fascinating history in the world. Satan has already begun in Genesis 10 to counterfeit what God would do. We can see that as we study this passage, that Nimrod was the human mind behind the first system of fall false religion. And Nimrod founds a city called Babel, Babylon, and was the home for the beginning of idolatry. See what it says in verse 8? Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord, and don't think hunt deer. That word is used everywhere else for hunting people. This guy was a commando army man hunter. He was a warrior, is what would be a better word for us to understand. He was a warrior before the Lord, and the beginning of his kingdom of Nimrod was Babel, Erech, Akkad, Calneh, the land of Shinar, and from that land he went to Assyria and built Nineveh, and Rehoboth-ur. Ur means city, and the city of Rehoboth, and Calneh, and Rezin between Nineveh and Calneh, and that's the principal city, and all that to say this, Nimrod is a very influential person. Now, Nimrod was the grandson of Ham. That means that he was the great-grandson of Noah. That means that he would have had direct knowledge of God from before the flood. So he is what the Bible would call an apostate. Apostate in English is from apostasia in Greek, and it means to fall away from, to no longer hold this belief. So he had this belief taught to him as a child of the one true and living God that was to be approached one way, and he fell from that, and he starts a different way to God. And he does it by building this tower, a ziggurat probably, this steps and pathway up to the heavens. It was a gateway to God or to the gods, and he builds the Tower of Babel. And what I'd like to read to you just before I go, these details, and there are lots of them. In fact, there's tremendous amount of literature that's written about this event, because this is the anthropological religious background of humanity, where all of world religions come from. It all stems from here. But secular history and tradition tell us Nimrod married a woman who was evil and demonic, and it was worse probably than he was. Her name from history is Semiramis. She seems to have understood God's promise of a future savior. Genesis 3:15, God says to Eve that the woman, not Eve, but the woman, is going to have a seed. Now, you know right away, women don't have seed. Men have seed. Women are the carriers and the one who receives and who gives birth to the child, but they don't initiate the child. The man does. It says a woman is going to have a virgin birth. That's what Genesis 3:15 says. As soon as Satan heard God say that to Eve, he went, wow. Another thing I can counterfeit. You know what the first plank of every pagan society is? All of them. All the Greek religions, all the Roman religions, all the Phoenician religions, all the Babylonian religions, all of the Egyptian lore, all of them have a sunbeam hitting a goddess, and the king of the gods, through the sunbeam, causes a virgin birth, a child without a human father. And so Semiramis at Babel says, I had that. My firstborn son, Tammuz, is not the child of Nimrod. He is the fulfillment of the prophecy of God, and he is the promised deliverer. You say, that's strange. Well, building on that promise of the woman's seed that was to come, Semiramis began to counterfeit the promise of the virgin birth of Christ. See, that's what Satan's always into. He is trying to bring something right next to it. So you have two choices, God's and the easier one. And that's what she offered. And thus was introduced the mystery of a mother and a virgin-born child. And that form of idolatry is older than any other idolatry on the planet. If you go back into the history of civilization, you find that that is the oldest form of idolatry there is. The mother-son, virgin-born, sunbeam-conceived child. It was Satan's effort to delude mankind with an imitation so like the truth that God, that people wouldn't know the true seed of the woman when he came in the fullness of time. In fact, one of the earliest church historians, Justin Martyr, wrote in the second century heavily about this because of the mystery religions coming into the church. Okay, now go to chapter 11. Look what happened. In chapter 11, this Nimrod guy builds a city. He builds Babel's tower. His wife starts Babylon's mystery religions, and it becomes organized religion. The Tower of Babel in Genesis 11, 1 through 9, was the advent of organized religion. It was 2,400 plus years before Christ, nearly 4,500 years ago, and the Tower of Babel was the first idol. It became the first object of man's worship. It was the point of their pride, and from it spawned all of what we call mystery religions. And you remember what God does? God reaches down and confuses them. They all spoke one language. It was kind of like one world, everything, language and government and everything. And God divided everybody off into people groups based on languages. Now, if you know anything about language, you know the Indo-European language and Sanskrit. You know, people really want to learn English, go to study Sanskrit in India. Why would they go there to learn English? Because there's a fountain from which all the Indo-European languages come. And that is just one branch that goes from the Tower of Babel. But they didn't just take language with them. They took this mother-child worship with them. Basically, the gospel of Satan is religion. He's made sure it got to every corner of the earth. At the Tower of Babel's worship ziggurat, the Babylonian mystery religions fill the pages of ancient history. They're everywhere, and they're still still with us today, and they all have common elements, no matter where you are on the planet. Alexander Hislop, a 19th century theologian and historian, spent his life tracing all of the false religions under the guise of their different names and making charts and finding the similarities. And this is what he found that's amazing. Semiramis, scattered into multiple language groups, becomes a goddess under many names. She became Ishtar of Syria, Ashtaroth of Phoenicia, Isis of Egypt, Aphrodite of Greece, and Venus of Rome, just to name a few. By the way, when Jesuit missionaries first got to Tibet, they were amazed at the mother-child paintings. They looked like they'd been imported from Rome. They worship a mother goddess with a virgin-born son, and they quickly converted to Christianity because it sounded so similar to the mother-child goddess and God. She conceived Tammuz, her virgin-born son, who became named Baal. Now, does that ring a bell? Ashtaroth of the Canaanites, the Phoenicians, became the mother of Baal, who was the snare, with Balaam bringing it in to the children of Israel, with Jezebel bringing it in. You understand that the whole Old Testament is about this desire for Satan to infiltrate. He wants to bring in Baal as the substitute for the coming Christ, the Son of the living God. That's the whole message of the Old Testament. That's what Elijah was saying. Which one are you going to pick? Are you going to pick the religious idol of Baal, or are you going to choose the true and living God who's going to come in human flesh, Jesus Christ? That's the message. He becomes not only Baal of Phoenicia, but Horus of Egypt, Eros of Greece, and Cupid of Rome. Venus's child Cupid, you know, as in the Valentines, the little naked kid, you know, with the bow and arrow, is this representation of the divine son, of the divine mother. The celebration of Tammuz had this element that most people don't even realize. When Semiramis had this child, she said he's the promised one. All of a sudden he was out with his dad and he got killed by a wild boar and torn into pieces. So Tammuz was in all these pieces, so Semiramis picks him up and puts him in a basket and weeps, puts her head over the basket and weeps for 40 days and 40 nights. And at the end of 40 days and 40 nights, Tammuz rises from the dead. And that 40-day mourning is in every pagan religion. And in the 4th century, it was brought into Roman Catholicism and called what? Lent. Now, where is Lent in the Bible? It's only in one place. It's in Ezekiel 8:14. It's weeping for Tammuz, and God condemned it as false, idolatrous paganism. All that to say this, when Babel was confounded, it became the fountain of all false religions, and that's why by the time we get to Revelation chapter 17, God portrays religion as a drunken woman with a big chalice filled with the blood of saints, that's Old Testament believers, and martyrs of Jesus, that's New Testament believers, and she's drinking that and the blood's flowing down her face. Really gross. You know what that is? That Babylon, the mother of all mystery religion. What's religion? Any way to God except the way he said. That is Satan's desire, to get people to avoid the one door and build a ramp in a different way. That's why there's no salvation in any other. There's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved other than the name of Jesus. You've never met Jesus Christ, and maybe today the Spirit of God, it clicked in your heart that you're just like Abel, that you are hopeless and helpless, can't save yourself, and you've been trying to build a little bridge to God and it hasn't worked, and all of a sudden you found out that Jesus is the way to God. You could call on him today, right where you're sitting. This is even more exciting than whatever's on TV. So let's bow for a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for the lens of Scripture. Thank you that it interprets for us history. We know our origin. We know the purpose you've left us here. And we, by faith, have embraced our destiny, which is in a sinless substitute. You, Lord Jesus, who poured out your life's blood as the atoning sacrifice for the sin of the world. And we place our faith, our hope, our trust in you. And I pray that you would help anyone here who is confused to find out that your word dispels the confusion. And when you take your word for what it says, finally everything makes sense. And I pray that you draw to yourself those who this morning have never met the Savior, and those that know you, that they be encouraged. And we ask that in the precious name of Jesus, and for his glory we pray, and all of God's people said, amen. God bless you as you go.
I should cast your country, set your name or your tribe. There's people always dying, trying to keep them alive. There's bodies decomposing in containers tonight, in an abandoned building where the squatters made a mural of a Mexican girl with 15 cans of spray paint in a chemical swirl. She's standing in the ashes at the end of the world, four winds blowing through her hair. But when great Satan's gone, the horror of Babylon, well, she just can't sustain the pressure where it's placed. She caves. The Bible's blind and tore his death, the Koran's mute. If you burned them all together, you'd get close to the truth still. They're pouring over Sanskrit under Ivy League moons, while shadows lengthen in the sun. Cast on a school of meditation built to soften the times and hold us at the center while the spiral unwinds. It's knocking over fences, crossing property lines. Four winds cry until it comes. It's the summer man clutching towards bed. Refugee retracing my steps all the way to Casadega to commune with the dead. They said you'd better look alive. And now it's off to old Dakota where a genocide sleeps, in the Black Hills, the Badlands, the calloused east. I buried my ballast, I made my peace.